And I guess speaking of the big time, let's talk about your 150K bug bounty payout on Immunify. Can you give us the bit of background on that? Yeah, tell me your story. How did you
All
go about
right.
finding the bug?
Okay, so I just want to give one huge disclaimer before we start, which is that there's this thing called survivor bias, I think, which everybody should know about. A survivorship bias, or yeah, which is the idea that you shouldn't necessarily listen to people who have actually succeeded because it could have been luck. And also, there's another thing, they might not actually know the reasons why they succeeded. So they may be doing something right, but they may not know why they're doing the right thing. And I think that definitely holds for me a little bit. But that being said, so yeah, well, that being said, I think you should just enjoy the story more than anything else. There might be a couple of bits of advice in there that might work for you, but then also I might really not have any substantial advice that's worth listening to at all. So I just want to put that out there as a disclaimer. But basically, the story was I was getting a little bit worried about not earning enough on Code Arena, even though my skills were definitely improving a lot, and I could tell that that was happening as well. I was personally proud of a lot of the findings I was finding, even if another seven wardens were finding it as well, or 30, as it sometimes is as is sometimes the case. Then I decided that I was actually going to look for a job at an auditing firm, and I was given a referral by another Code Arena contestant to Oak Security, and I did a couple of interviews with them, and I did end up getting an offer of doing a trial audit with them, which we can talk about later. But I had a week off, and I had done a couple of days here and there of looking around on Immunify and even searching through some source code for some bugs, but nothing deep. And I thought, I've got a week off. I'm going to choose my target really carefully, and I'm just going to see if what happens. And basically, I chose Notional as the one I was going to look at because I'd actually done a contest, a C4 contest for Notional, and it's unrelated. The contest is unrelated to the bug I found. But I remember while reading the code base that I thought it was a complex code base. Now, there's a certain amount of complexity that's unavoidable when a project has a lot of features. And I think that's the case for this project as well. I don't think it has any extraneous complexity. But it is a complex code base, and I just think there's more chance of there being a bug in a complex code base. Anyway, the main thing I sort of did strategy-wise was I read through, there's been a few contests that Notional has done on C4, so I started reading through the old reports, and the first thing I did is sort of check whether those findings had been mitigated or attended to after the audit contest was over. And by and large, I found that was the case, and I didn't find the bug because of anything I read in the report. But what it did, the good thing about doing that was that it did give me a lot of ideas about where to kind of look, like what kind of areas were people finding bugs in. And so eventually I sort of settled upon the idea that there might be some kind of problem with automated market making that occurs in there. That's kind of funny, like, because the bug didn't actually end up being to do anything to do with automated market makers. But that's kind of where I was looking. And so I thought, well, if I want to manipulate prices, I want to do a flash loan. And so that was the first thing I did. And the other thing I did is I said, on this particular bug bounty, I'm going to use Foundry as my tool, and I'm going to work with the state of the project as it is on the actual Ethereum mainnet. I'm going to fork the state. I'm not going to just set up the contracts in some state. And this ended up being a really, really good approach because I didn't have to set up. There's a lot of state in this project. And if I'd had to set that up from scratch, it would have been really hard because I would have had to like understand the code basically as well as the devs do, which I wouldn't say I'm at that stage yet. And by actually just interacting with the contracts as they are on mainnet, obviously forked and running on my laptop and not actually submitting transactions, by interacting with the contracts in that state, I was able to sort of be more realistic, or what I was working with was more realistic. And I think that's actually what allowed me to find the bug in the end, was basically the contract got into a particular state that wasn't tested in any of their test cases, because there are many different states that particular project can get into. And basically, I found the bug completely by accident in the end. What I thought I would do is just one of the simplest, I was just basically setting up my test infrastructure. So, okay, wait, I'll go back a bit. The first thing I did is write a lot of logging code. So just lots and lots of console.log functions, which would give me lots of interesting information on the state of the actual project, like how much money was in a particular pool, for instance, and what the prices were and what the expected return, this is a lending platform, what the expected returns were and that kind of stuff. So I could just get a feel for what state the project was in. And then I thought, well, I just have to write the simplest test case I think I can do. So what I'll do is I'll get a flash loan, I'll dump a whole bunch of money into this liquidity token, and then I'll try and redeem that liquidity token. And I was expecting that when I did this, I would get out less money than I put in, because there's going to be some fees and I'm doing it within one transaction and I haven't yet got the rewards that you would get. And that was actually what happened the first time. But this redeem function had several flags which you could pass to it. And I just literally kind of tried out all the different flags, and there was one particular combination where suddenly a little bit of extra money came out. And that was the moment that I knew I'd found something. And it's a really full-on moment, because the first thing I thought was, I've made a mistake. I've definitely made a mistake. This couldn't be that easy. You shouldn't really have found it this early on in your bug hunting process. What's happened here? You've made some mistake. You're reading the numbers wrong or something like that. And I just spent the next half an hour checking it over and over and over again until I was certain that I genuinely had received extra money out of it. And the way I sort of convinced myself of this was by actually just running ERC20 balance of, calling the function balance of calls on it to see whether the contract had actually had less money in it than before I'd done this attack on it. And it had less money in it, so I knew it was legit after a while. And I hadn't drained very much, because I hadn't done it fully the right way. And so at that stage, I knew I was onto something, sort of was quietly hopeful that I could slowly increase the amount of economic damage that I did to the project, all hypothetical, of course, because they have a clause that they pay out 10% of economic damage. And I didn't know if they were going to take that seriously or not. There was part of me that thought, oh, well, maybe if you just show them the exploit, they'll work out what the maximum economic damage could have been and then pay you whatever that is. That didn't actually turn out to be the case. So that's one hint I would definitely give to people, is if you do find something, then spend a little bit of extra time trying to maximize the amount of economic damage you cause with that exploit, because they can take that 10% rule very literally, which is totally fair. By the way, I'm not complaining about that at all, but I wasn't sure whether it would work that way, and it could be different for the different projects, but for this particular project, that's how it worked. And in the end, it turned out that the maximum economic damage I could have caused would have been maybe 15% more, so I could have got 15% more than the 150k. So, but that's neither here nor there. It was a lot of money, and I'm very, very happy with the whole experience. I'll tell some fun parts of the story now. The moment I'd found it, say goodbye to good night's sleep. I just didn't sleep well for the next 4 days, and I completely burnt myself out. I was trying to sleep too. I was doing all the right things, put on some white noise, I wanted to be fresh for the next day, but I just couldn't help it. I was having very, very sleepless nights because it was just this kind of potentially amazing thing. And plus there was a lot of fear about whether it was going to work out or not, which was actually really hard to deal with. And I'm having trouble putting myself back in that mindset of where I was at that time, because it was my first big bounty. I was really, really worried that it wasn't going to work out, or that they were going to find some flaw in my logic or say that it wasn't legit or something like that. That's just something that you might have to deal with if the same thing happens to you. But it was a very real thing. Eventually, I had kind of run out of time because my audit with Oak was about to start, and I had to take that seriously. So I thought, I haven't actually established what the root cause of this bug is, but I know some pretty good candidate functions, or I know it is in these functions somewhere, but I don't know the exact reason why it's happening. So that's kind of interesting. I successfully received a bounty for something that I didn't 100% know the root cause for. But I guess what couldn't be argued with, because I wrote a POC that was executable, what couldn't be argued with was that if you ran my POC, they had $1.5 million less money in their contracts at the end of it. So that's very important. The POC really does have to actually, you do have to write the POC, and it actually has to drain the money. So make sure you do that. So I submitted it to them. It was also, I think, the right thing to do to submit it when I did, because someone else might have found it and they might have not been a white hat hacker and they might have actually stolen $1.5 million. And Notional has now only had to pay out $150,000 rather than lose $1.5 million, which is obviously good for them. I think it was important just from an ethical standpoint to be pretty timely with my report. So I did that. I'll run you through the process of what happened. I believe the time zone was New York time zone for them. And I think it was about 8:30 at night. It could have been later. So I definitely ruined someone's night. But they got back to me almost immediately, which was really amazing. And they were extremely cordial, very polite, very good writing. I was really impressed with the process. They really saw the value in the bug bounty program, and they stuck to the rules. And I had a verbal confirmation in Immunify. A written communication in Immunify saying that they thought that the bug was legitimate, and that they didn't say how much they were going to pay me at that stage, but they said they'd get back to me within 1 day. And then within 1 day, they said 10% of economic damage, you'll get $150,000. And that was great. However, it did take about, I'd say, 2.5 weeks for the bounty to actually get paid out. And although they stayed in communication and they were very polite and cordial, and I had no reason to believe that I wasn't going to receive it, it still did weigh heavily on my mind. It wasn't real until the actual USDC was in the address that I provided to them. Eventually, I did something kind of fun. I ended up writing a little script which would monitor the address and then play Celebrate Good Times, the song. And I had that running, and I had the laptop on all night. So, because I knew I'd probably get paid in the middle of the night while I was asleep. And eventually that ended up happening. So I was deep asleep when it happened. And all of a sudden, Celebrate Good Times is blaring out of the other room, and I stumble in bleary-eyed, and there's some money in my account. It was really amazing. Actually, at that stage, it was only $1, because I'd asked them to send a small amount first just to check that everything was fine. But then I got received the other transactions within half an hour. So that was pretty amazing. Why did it take so long for them to pay it out? Because of their own economic organization of their projects. They don't pay the bounties out of the actual project itself. They have another legal entity that they have, and they had to just put some actual US dollars in Coinbase, and that took a while to clear, and that's all that was. There's some other fun bits about the story as well. So my son had actually given me viral conjunctivitis during the whole thing. So I actually, despite being sleepless as well, I looked terrible as well because my eyes were like really, really red. I think they call it pink eye. The Americans call it pink eye. Anyway, so I looked terrible and I just looked like death warmed up. And even after the bounty had been confirmed, it still took me about another 4 to 5 days for my sleep to return to normal. I slowly just relaxed more and more, and eventually life got back to normal and I was sleeping normally. It was quite an emotional experience. I suspect it won't be like that if I find any more bounties in the future. I suspect it'll be a much more relaxed process, but maybe not, I don't know. But yeah, this one was really quite stressful in good and bad ways. Yeah.